Permítame saludar a Mark Durban. Repito, él es miembro del Parlamento Británico por el Partido Socialdemócrata Laborista y fue clave en la negociación de aquel Viernes Santo en que el gobierno británico le puso fin al conflicto, al terrible conflicto con Irlanda del Norte. Esta era una pelea entre unionistas y protestantes republicanos. Las negociaciones allí duraron más de 20 meses. Trabajó con John Hume, que ha estado con nosotros, el ganador del premio Nobel y uno de los hombres más importantes en este proceso. Ellos vivieron terribles acciones de violencia terroristas por parte del IRA, Ejército Republicano Irlandés. El señor Durkan conoce mucho el tema del proceso de paz en La Habana. Señor Durkan, gracias por estar con nosotros. Buenos días.
Buenos días.
Mariana, la primera pregunta para el señor Durkan es: de las objeciones que tienen los amigos del no, quienes tienen puntos de vista distintos, que no están de acuerdo con el acuerdo de paz, ¿él le daría la razón a alguno de esos puntos? Es decir, ¿él entiende por qué una persona dice no porque no está de acuerdo con qué?
Mr. Durkan, thank you so much for joining us. The first question we have for you is, from all the objections that people express towards the peace process, from those who oppose the peace process, which one do you understand the most? So if a person opposes the peace process, you would say, I understand that you oppose it because of this exact reason.
When people have suffered directly because of the violence that was used in the conflict, and no matter at whose hands they suffered, those are people who will have very natural reasons to doubt whether or not the peace process can work. I can understand the feelings of people who have suffered directly from violence, but in our own experience, when you talk to such people, they also draw on the pain of their suffering to recognize that one of the compelling needs for a peace process is to make sure that no one else endures that sort of suffering in the future, and therefore that the argument is not against the peace process, but is to make sure that the peace process is going to be robust and reliable, and it has to be credible on some of the harder questions that can be asked of a peace process.
Él entiende el caso de aquellas personas que han sufrido en manos de la violencia, que son víctimas de la violencia. Esos son los casos que entiende. Pero también dice que por experiencia personal, muchas de esas personas que sufren a causa de la violencia también entienden la necesidad de llegar a un acuerdo para que esas cosas no se vuelvan a repetir. Ahora, la oposición de esas personas no es tanto a una paz en sí o a un acuerdo en sí, sino es más un sentimiento de querer asegurarse que que el acuerdo sea robusto para que esas situaciones de violencia no se repitan en el futuro.
Precisamente los temas que más controversia han generado en nuestro país es cómo va a responder la guerrilla ante la justicia y su incursión en la política. ¿Cómo se negoció el tema de la justicia con el IRA? ¿Y hoy qué hacen las personas que dejaron las armas en ese entonces?
So what about the subject of justice and peace, and how exactly, for example, in the case of Ireland and the Good Friday Agreement, how those terms were agreed to and how did they come about after the signing of the peace process? As you know, in Colombia, there's a lot of objection in terms of the justice that the FARC will face after the signing of a peace process and their entrance into politics. So can you tell us more about the case of the agreement that you helped draft, and how did it come about after it was signed?
Well, I believe that the Colombian peace process has learned some of the lessons from mistakes and failures in our own process, in that the Good Friday Agreement provided for prison releases. It provided for a new beginning in terms of policing to be worked on with international support. It provided for decommissioning to be developed but didn't have the plans fully nailed down. And so when it came to the implementation of our agreement, we didn't have fulfilment. There were lots of arguments about the interpretation of different parts of the agreement, and therefore we fell down on aspects of implementation. But our biggest failure was we left the questions of the past to be addressed at a different stage, and we are still only getting around to dealing with questions of the past in Northern Ireland now. And so I believe that the Colombian process, which saw representatives of victims actually able to go to Havana to talk to the table, to have questions of transitional justice directly addressed in the agreement, I think has been a much more mature and complete process than we achieved in Northern Ireland.
El proceso de paz en Colombia ha sido un proceso más maduro que el que se llevó a cabo entre los británicos y los irlandeses. ¿Por qué? Él dice que específicamente ellos dejaron a un lado temas del pasado que eran las, digamos, raíces del conflicto. Y en el caso de Colombia, el hecho de que las víctimas tengan una voz, que vayan, por ejemplo, a La Habana y que tengan una presencia, eso es una cosa que ellos, por ejemplo, no tuvieron. Digamos que es una lección que los colombianos aprendimos de ese proceso, al igual que otras lecciones. Él también dice que fallaron un poco en la implementación, en algunos aspectos de la implementación del proceso de paz de ellos, del acuerdo, porque habían cosas que no estaban muy concretas y que se prestaban para diferentes interpretaciones para ambos lados. Entonces, que esa clase de cosas él cree, en términos de justicia, en términos de cómo entraron las FARC a la política, que están mucho más desarrolladas en el proceso de paz colombiano.
Mariana, como en Colombia, en Irlanda del Norte se llevó a cabo un referendo pues para que los ciudadanos se pronunciaran sobre el acuerdo de paz. Por favor, pregúntele a nuestro invitado cuál es la necesidad de refrendar un acuerdo de paz y si esto no genera mayor polarización al interior de la sociedad.
Just like in Colombia, you had a referendum. You also asked the people of your country if they were in agreement with the Good Friday Agreement. What is the necessity, in your view, of having a referendum? Doesn't this create more polarization?
In Ireland's context, the referendum was hugely important because it was really two referendums within one, because we were dealing with a situation whereby people have very different views as to whether Northern Ireland should be in the United Kingdom or whether Northern Ireland should be part of a United Ireland. So unionists believe in the United Kingdom, nationalists believe in the United Ireland. We were trying to achieve an agreement that would mean we could share institutions, that we could have agreed political institutions. And to do that, we had to recruit and respect the sense and source of legitimacy which unionists have, which is bound up in the wishes of the majority of people in Northern Ireland, but also Irish nationalists like myself, our sense and source of legitimacy is bound up in the wishes of the Irish people as a whole. So for the first time ever in history, having a referendum to endorse an agreement which had to be supported by a majority in Northern Ireland and also by a majority in the South, which thereby added up to a majority in the island as a whole, we were able to make sure that our new institutions were legitimate for both traditions, because people can only give their allegiance to institutions that are legitimate according to their political ethics. So that was the very particular reason why we had this double referendum as a sort of a form of articulated self-determination in our context. The case for a referendum in other contexts is different, but of course the more that the outcome of the referendum can show that there is a support that transcends all of the political interests and outlooks, then the more robust the agreement will be.
Él dice que en los casos generales, un referendo o digamos que el hecho de que la gente vote por semejante acuerdo le da mucho más poder, hace que el acuerdo sea mucho más robusto. En el caso de Irlanda del Norte era un caso bastante particular porque ellos tenían que, digamos, sembrar un sentido de que las instituciones fueran legítimas después de que el acuerdo se firmara, y para ello tenían que tener el consenso de los nacionalistas, aquellos que querían que Irlanda fuera parte de la isla de Irlanda, Irlanda del Norte, perdón, parte de la isla de Irlanda, y de los unionists, o los que, digamos, querían la unión con el Reino Unido. Entonces, digamos que pasar este referendo, que en verdad fueron dos referendos en uno, ellos tenían que garantizar que ambos bandos estuvieran de acuerdo con él para así darle legitimidad al acuerdo.
Señor Duncan, en base a los acuerdos de paz de Irlanda del Norte, ¿qué sucedió con los máximos dirigentes del IRA? ¿Fueron a la cárcel? Y si es así, ¿cuánto tiempo llevan o si siguen todavía en prisión?
What about with the biggest IRA leaders? What happened to them? Did they go to jail? And if that is the case, are they still there? Were they freed? What really happened to them?
Well, some IRA leaders had been in jail. Some were still in jail at the time we negotiated the agreement. The agreement provided for prison releases to take no longer than 2 years after the endorsement of the agreement. And so people who were convicted of crimes, whether they were loyalist paramilitaries or Republican paramilitaries, they were released after 2 years from the agreement. And if anybody is convicted since the agreement, if anybody is convicted of a crime that was committed during the Troubles, then the maximum time they would serve in prison would be 2 years. As I indicated earlier, this was something that was very difficult for people who had been victims of violence to accept from at the hands of whatever force they suffered violence. But nevertheless, people recognized in the overall context that we weren't going to get an agreement that didn't address the issue of the prisons, that didn't see prisoners released.
Muchos estaban ya en la cárcel, fueron liberados. Aquellos, por ejemplo, el máximo tiempo que estuvieron en la cárcel después de la firma del acuerdo fue 2 años. Aquellos que fueron sentenciados después del acuerdo del Viernes Santo por los crímenes que se cometieron durante la era de violencia podían tener una sentencia máxima de 2 años en la cárcel. Fue muy difícil para ellos llegar a ese acuerdo, para las víctimas de la violencia y para los familiares de las víctimas también fue muy duro, pero en un contexto general ellos están de acuerdo en que eso era la medida necesaria para llegar a una paz en el país.
A propósito de la refrendación y del plebiscito en Colombia, un ejemplo reciente sería el Brexit. El Brexit no era necesario, pero sin embargo el señor Cameron estaba seguro que lo ganaba y finalmente lo perdió y le tocó irse. ¿No le ronda a él la posibilidad de que en Colombia tengamos nuestro Brexit con el proceso de paz?
So a lot of people compare the Colombian referendum of the peace process with Brexit and the referendum to remain in the European Union. The Prime Minister didn't actually believe there was a chance of voters voting out. Do you think that could actually happen with us? Is that a possibility as well?
Well, I am not close enough to the mood of people across the country in Colombia to know whether or not the referendum might be defeated. I certainly hope not, and I think it's important that if the referendum does succeed, the more that it can be shown that people supported this agreement right across the country, the more that different political and social interests can be shown to have endorsed the agreement, then the stronger any agreement will be. What David Cameron had tried to do with the Brexit referendum was to try to solve a problem that had been long-standing in his own party, using a hastily called referendum around ideas that a lot of people didn't understand. Hopefully the referendum in Colombia is taking place on issues that are understood by people, where people are clear about what the choices are and are positive about what the prospects that could be released by the referendum would actually be. So I hope that it is a positive outcome, unlike the Brexit referendum. But it is about the Colombian people making their own choice to solve a 20th century conflict and create a 21st century peace.
Las condiciones del Brexit era más un intento del primer ministro Cameron, de solucionar un problema interno de su partido político, y digamos que fue un poco apresurado y era un tema que la gente del Reino Unido no entendía muy bien, y también por eso se debe el resultado que vimos respecto a ese referendo. Ahora, él no sabe muy bien qué va a pasar con el referendo en Colombia, él espera que pase, pero dice que también es importantísimo que la gente en Colombia esté enterada de lo que está en juego con este referendo, de la importancia y las consecuencias que pueden venirse, ya sea el escenario, ya sea que venga el escenario por el sí, que gane el sí o que gane el no.
Del extenso acuerdo que se firmó, que se firma hoy en Cartagena, el punto que a mi juicio es más controvertible es la creación de un Tribunal Especial para la Paz integrado por extranjeros. Es decir, que el Tribunal Especial para la Paz tendrá la mitad integrado por colombianos y la otra mitad por extranjeros. ¿Qué opinión le merece el hecho de que haya extranjeros en el Tribunal Especial para la Paz que debe determinar el futuro de las personas involucradas en el conflicto?
We are talking specifically about the tribunal that is to determine the sentences or those subjects surrounding justice for those people who are going to be tried. And it is composed half by nationals, Colombian nationals, and half by foreigners. Can you please tell us a little bit about your opinion? Because in the country, it's been a bit contentious. A lot of people don't agree with the fact that foreigners are part of the tribunal. What, in your view, does this mean? What is your opinion about it?
Well, as I indicated earlier, I think in the Colombian process, people have been a lot more mature about facing up to the need to deal with the past and to deal with the requirements for transitional justice. We cannot pretend that crimes did not happen. We cannot simply pass over what happened. People have the right to seek justice, and the Colombian agreement has made provision for that. So while what are called political crimes might be indemnified, clear violations of human rights and violations against individuals will not be. And I think that is right and proper. But in any process, people will always have their questions about who is taking the decisions regarding justice. And when past events are being looked at again, people will accord bias to the part of judges or other people involved in the process. And that is why it is positive to have an international dimension as well, so that people can't say these were personal choices, these were personal grudges, or these were partisan decisions taken to try to upset the peace process for some internal political reason. So the fact that there will be an international dimension helps to provide safeguards. And in our process, we have used international persons. The work on decommissioning involved the contribution of people from outside the country, and the times when we have tried to deal with things in the past, and when we brought forward our proposals for a new beginning to policing, that was based on the work of an internationally led commission. So sometimes you cannot get purely internal solutions or purely internal answers that are going to stand up free of criticism. And so I think in the Colombian situation, you have come up with a balance.
En su opinión, el que existan extranjeros y que sean parte ellos del tribunal garantiza una especie de balance, porque digamos que muchos pueden pensar que hay prejuicios de personas que probablemente quisieran sabotearse el proceso de paz o que quisieran ayudar a su implementación. Entonces, el hecho de que existan miembros de la comunidad internacional presentes en un organismo como tal garantiza un cierto balance, una perspectiva, digamos, menos empapada de lo que ha pasado en el país y por lo tanto más objetiva. En el caso de ellos también han tenido miembros de la comunidad internacional que han sido parte de la implementación del acuerdo del Viernes Santo, y esa es una medida que en su opinión ha servido mucho.
Todas las encuestas dicen que va a ganar el sí. Hoy tendremos la encuesta nuestra. Pero igual que el Brexit, se puede dar una sorpresa. Si gana el no, ¿el qué piensa que pasa? ¿Al otro día, el 3 de octubre, las FARC vuelven al monte, o hay alguna posibilidad de que no se pierdan los 4 años y se siga en la mesa de negociación?
You know, all polls basically indicate that a yes vote will prevail, but you never know. And we have the example of Brexit, which the polls told us something, and then last minute we found out there was a surprise. If Colombians vote no on the 2nd of October, what do you think will happen on the 3rd? Are the FARC going to go back into the jungle and continue with their fight? And or how easy is it for them to continue a dialogue with the government?
Well, I know that President Santos has said that the only plan B, if the referendum was defeated, was that the conflict would continue. What form the conflict would continue in, I wouldn't want to speculate. I think what we have to do is to concentrate on the positive, to concentrate on the potential that is there. What could a yes vote mean? A yes vote could mean that this peace is sealed. It could mean a new emancipation where all of the resources of the people of Colombia are dedicated to constructing and growing the economy, a new emancipation where people are not fighting against their own state, but instead where people are bringing their political challenge, their political imperatives into the national political process, undertaking their place in democratic dialogue alongside everybody else. So I think we should concentrate on what a yes vote would actually mean, rather than be accused of possibly trying to scaremonger about what a no vote would mean, because one of the experiences we had in the Brexit referendum campaign was that both sides were accused of scaremongering and campaigning on negative arguments. And I think it's important that when people in Colombia are making their choice, they make a choice for positive reasons and are able to feel confident that they're making a choice for positive reasons, rather than out of any sort of fear or intimidation. So I think people in Colombia are experienced enough now to know what choices they are going to be making next weekend.
Mr. Durkin, thank you so much for your time. It was a pleasure having you on our show.
Thank you very much.
Bueno, el señor Durkin dice que es del presidente Santos, tal como lo dijo, puede que vuelvan las FARC a la guerra otra vez, a pelear. Y él no se quiere imaginar en qué términos o cuál sería el escenario específico de esa segunda guerra, pero a él sí le gustaría concentrarse en lo positivo que vendría si la gente, si los colombianos votamos por el sí. Él dice que uno de los errores de las campañas, de ambas campañas del Brexit, aquellas que se oponían al Brexit, fue que se concentraron mucho en los aspectos negativos, y ese es un error que podemos volver a cometer acá. Entonces, los colombianos tenemos que estar conscientes de las consecuencias positivas que puede traer un voto al sí y la implementación de un proceso de paz, y él recomienda que aquellos que estén de acuerdo con el proceso de paz se concentren en eso.
Gracias, Mariana. Muy interesante personaje, uno de los protagonistas de la paz de Irlanda, bueno, y protagonista también de la paz de Colombia, porque ha sido una de las personas más consultadas. El acuerdo de